In case you don't know, he was a student here at Stanford. He pioneered top-of-the-line networking, open flow, virtual networking. He then co-founded and was the CTO of Nicira. Later on, he was the senior vice president in VMware, in charge of network and security. And now he is a general partner in Andreessen Horowitz, and we're happy to have him here. Thank you for coming. So essentially the thing that kind of made this talk possible was I read recently in your blog that you're essentially saying cloud infrastructure is the place to be today, and you should go and start more companies in cloud infrastructure. And for me, it's very exciting being a cloud infrastructure PhD student. So I wanted to ask you kind of in general, why cloud infrastructure now?
Okay. Well, I want to like remove cloud infrastructure and just say infrastructure.
Yeah. Right?
Just because I think cloud is pretty ambiguously defined, and I actually think it's like we're seeing big shifts away from the cloud. Mm-hmm. Like hardcore systems infrastructure, I think is a great place to be, and I think it's a great place to be in two ways. So I think as we go through the beginning. By the way, thanks everybody for taking the time in the evening to be here. That's great. I really appreciate it. I know how important evenings are, so I really do. So I think what we'll do is we'll have like a pretty light conversation, and I'll, you know, answer questions at a high level, but I'm super happy to dig into anything deeper. And so please, like, you know, we'll do Q&A and ask questions and so forth. That way, I'm not like doing like some long monologue, etc. Like as we go through the schedule.
Sure.
Okay. Right. I'm like emceeing. Like, okay. So for two reasons, core infrastructure is changing in pretty fundamental ways. And by core infrastructure, I mean compute, networking, and service. Compute, networking, and storage. And it's changing. It's changing in two ways. One of them is everything is moving up a layer. So like the old compute, networking, and storage abstractions, I think that space is commoditized and it's dead. It's like hard to see much innovation there. Yes, there will be innovation, but I don't see like a lot of activity there. But what you are seeing is you are seeing almost an emergence of a new skinny waist, just like IP was a skinny waist, and that is at the microservices level. And like just as like a quick anecdote, like if I drive up 101, like it's so crazy. Like I think at last week I was driving up one of them. There's maybe four or five billboards for companies where the only interface is an API. Right? That's unbelievable. It's like there's PubMed, there's Braintree, like the entire interface. It's not HTML, it's not a UI, it's not shippable software. Like the entire interface is an API. And these are like billion-dollar companies like Twilio, right? And so we're kind of moving into this world now where like apps really are kind of these loosely federated connections of functions, and it's almost like, I mean, we used to say every program could be a company. Now it's almost like any function can be a company. Does that make sense? And that means that we basically have to retool all of the infrastructure, right? Because that's kind of the new skinny waist. So, and so from like a good news perspective, it's like you've got really deep semantics at the application, at the API layer, right? Like you know the difference between read and write. Like at the IP layer, you have no idea, right? Or the block level, like, you know. You know, structured data. I mean, you're seeing like the CI/CD pipeline kind of standardized, so you can actually insert tools there. So I think that we're seeing like this massive amount of innovation at a layer in the stack, which to me as a developer is kind of much more interesting. So that's one area where like there's a huge shift, and there's also a huge shift around developers as buyers, which is maybe less interesting to this group, but it's just as big a transition. I'm happy to talk about that if you guys want to. But the other shift, and this is going to sound a lot more weird, but I really believe it's true in infrastructure. It's like, okay, this is going to sound weird, but I'm just going to give it a go anyway. It's like, okay, so the internet has been kind of information in and information out for a very long time. If you look at companies that we've built that are kind of internet type companies, it's like they do information processing primarily. But there's a lot of vectors that have happened in the last decade, which it almost feels like the internet's growing like a prefrontal cortex and eyes and ears and hands, and it's reaching out and manipulating the physical world. And the net effect of that is like really mature industries that manipulate atoms, things like mining, forestry, agriculture, automotive, all of those are being transformed in a rate that we've never seen before ever. And while we like to look at, oh, like, you know, self-driving cars or automated agriculture, the reality is all of these things need pretty new infrastructure to make them run. And in fact, I've invested in a number of companies that like help like robotics and help in AI. And like if you looked at these companies, they're building hardcore like systems infrastructure. So we're seeing a massive revolution, like both like moving up stack and then also moving out. And so I think like there's been this view that things have been dying, but I don't believe it.
But I would like to latch on one sec to the microservice part. We've all heard about the microservice revolution. It's very exciting, right? You can essentially write your little code and have an API. It will be great. But then you're seeing products from Amazon come out, like Amazon Lex and a bunch of their AI suits. And it kind of feels like we're also going slowly nearing a consolidation in that area as well, where as a developer, you have a lot of incentive to just stick to Amazon tools and microservices.
That's great.
And it's hard. How could a startup enter such an environment?
Yeah. No, that's a super question. So let's maybe first define microservices so we can like have a sensible conversation. Mm-hmm. So microservices used to be kind of a development paradigm that was like loosely coupled within one organization. Right? So like if you're gonna build something, make sure it's modular and it has an API and then you publish it and other people can use it. And the net effect was to improve the software engineering process. Mm-hmm. That's not what I'm talking about. That to me is not microservices, that's like good software design. To me, the movement towards microservices is, you know, entire products are basically available only via APIs. It's this idea that you can actually federate and decouple functionality that way. And so, to me, that actually means, and by the way, here's an interesting anecdote. I won't say the names of companies because I don't know confidentiality, but like we're dealing with a shipping company. Like it actually deals with like crates and products where the only API, the only interface is an API, right? So for me, if you get up the stack enough, it's kind of ludicrous to say that Amazon can do all of these because the API is just the interface to some market or some company or some vertical, right? Mm-hmm. So unless they can do everything, like they can do, you know, shipping and agriculture and mining and you know all of this stuff that they don't do or are not interested in doing, like at some point. So I think that like when it comes to microservices, I think, listen, like HTML was arguably a skinny waist, IP was a skinny waist, I think like web services and the API is gonna be a skinny waist, and I think it's for all of business. So there's an insertion point there. There's another very interesting question, which is, okay, well, shit, I'm gonna create a software company, and I'm gonna do open source software, and then Amazon can take that and go ahead and run it on AWS and mm-hmm. offer it for free, so maybe we'll never do software infrastructure companies again.
Yeah.
So here's my one response to that. So we've been tracking this very, very closely. And it seems that it's getting to the point that, yes, that happens, and yes, it can happen. So if you have to build that next database company, like this is real. But what's happening in practice is, in order to be successful in infrastructure, if you're building a product company, you need a sales force, and Amazon just can't maintain that many sales forces. It's just impossible. Like in as much as like sales, and then the enterprise sales is everything. So unless like Amazon can do that, like they're not gonna be effective. And the second thing is, it turns like they're kind of victims of their own success where they're, I mean, like I said, they're defying the laws of physics, how fast they're growing, and it's an amazing company, and I have a ton of respect for it, but like if you look at the versions of the shit they have up there, it's like old and crufty and not well maintained, and it just they don't have like the internal focus to do that. And so I think for some really core things it'll happen, but I think that this is a very, very heavy tailed problem, and I think there's a majority of opportunity within that. I'm so scared of that.
Well, you do see like a lot more companies today which are doing multi-cloud and stuff, right? Essentially.
I've for years tried to either fund companies or create companies that were basically a core value proposition was multi-cloud. So like that was a core value proposition. Like, listen, you don't want to be stuck in one cloud, one two clouds, doesn't work. It's like it could be a secondary value proposition, but there were a dozen companies out there that that's their primary value proposition, which is like core decoupling, and it's just not enough of a need. And the reason is the reality for cloud workloads from the enterprise view is they really are cloud specific. So like the Microsoft specific shit and Microsoft and like the Gen 3 stuff is in Amazon. And so, I mean, they don't really, you know, so I think that they all like that from a value perspective, but I don't think it's a primary perspective. So I wouldn't, listen, if you're off to go do like Acme Inc., I wouldn't have a core value proposition be cloud independence. It just doesn't work. It's been tried so many times.
So returning to the whole discussion on API, it kind of almost sounds like you're advocating this API to the fog, if I may use some keywords. Like essentially, your APIs are going to connect to things which are not in the cloud itself, like phones or shipping containers or.
I honestly believe that we're like, this is just the next. So my micro level view is like, okay, the internet like managed like lots of information, and now it's going out just kind of managing everything, and it's doing it pretty effectively. And I think that there's a sufficient maturation, and a lot of this is a business, and we can have a business conversation around this, sufficient maturation in the buying process and the consumption process, that if I have a good to offer the world, it makes sense for me to offer it as an API. Like the software market is large enough and everybody has an iPhone and like there's enough money made from apps that like I don't have to like go direct. I can offer something as an API. I mean, Twilio does SMS. That's what the SMS is. Only API. It's $5 billion company. And so more and more, like you've got Stripe, you've got Braintree, you've got all of these companies that API is the way that's interfacing it. So I actually think that because we're much more sophisticated as an industry, and because developers have so much more clout within organizations, which they haven't been in the past. Like when I started my career doing distributed programming in Lawrence Livermore National Labs as like a computational researcher, and I didn't have budget for pencil. Seriously, like you show up and like you didn't have root on your own machine, like they told you your Unix environment, like they gave you all the tools and you sat and coded. And if you compare that in 2000 to what you see today, I mean, developers will actually control purchasing decisions for infrastructure. Like, I want Kubernetes, right? I want, you know, this. And because they actually control budget and purchasing decisions, developers run the show. And how does a developer like to consume something? As an API, right?
Yeah.
And so, you know, being in computer science, we've seen this and we've said this many times in the past, but like the industry's never been able to execute on it. Like, of course, we know everything should have APIs because we're computer scientists and we like to program, but it's very different to be like, okay, company X, okay, IBM, you're not buying this product unless basically I can control it just from a program. And that's one of the biggest shifts that's happening in industry right now is we're seeing this movement from basically an HCI problem of like fiddling around with things, whether it's a standalone program or a website, to actually being driven from software.
It sounds almost like you're going to end up going where you have the cross API is going to be like your main issue.
Exactly. So I think that's the new skinny waist. Like, remember, IP was like the it's like a classic skinny waist, right? Which is, you know, it's like everything under IP, like you got like Ethernet, you got whatever, like all the hardware things, and then everything on top of IP, like all the protocols on top of it. And that was like the only common point. So when you build something to insert in the infrastructure, you can insert it at that level, right? Firewalls, IDS, whatever. I mean, you could argue that you had a skinny waist with HTML. But the thing with HTML is like there wasn't a lot of semantics because it's really an HCI problem. And so like you have a ton of infrastructure that went at the HTML level, right? You have like web proxies, you have WAF, etc. But like it was a pretty fractured market because it wasn't that skinny of a waist. I would argue that really if you go to microservices in a fundamental way, you've got a new skinny waist where like you can sit there, it's like it's puts, it's gets, we understand structured data, so now you can redo the shit that we've done. You know, in IP there, we can do APM, you know, performance management, we can do firewalling, we can do intrusion detection, we can do, you know, interesting caching, but you're doing it at a more interesting level because it's semantically meaningful. It's not just, you know, like the five tuple. And I think that it's pretty common. So, I mean, this is early days for sure, but we're seeing a lot of movement in the space. If you guys keep track of like, you guys know who Apigee is? Yeah, so Apigee is an API gateway company. ESB market just got acquired by Google for $650 million. And this is a real space, a real business, and you're seeing a lot of heat around it right now. So it's an interesting space to keep an eye on.
So coming from the NetSeminar perspective, this is a NetSeminar event. It sounds like moving data from one microservice to another might actually become, again, a bottleneck, right? If you're using so many different APIs, which can be located in so many different places. How do you think, like, will that end up affecting the network? Will we need a new networking company to allow this? Or?
I'm not sure if, like, data movement, like, I think, like, IP does a good job from that. Like, I think, here's what, like, core networking, like, what I studied in school is good at. It's moving things between point A and point B in a complex graph. Like, we're rad at that. Like, you know, like we've invented thousands of ways to do it, and we only use one of those ways. So, like, if we decide not to use that one way, well, we've got like a ton more to actually do. So, like, so that we're really good at, and then everything else we're bad at. right? We're bad at access controls. We have no idea who's accessing data. We're horribly bad at it. We're actually pretty damn bad at load balancing. We're not good at caching because we've done, like, you can't do that at that level.
Mm-hmm.
So I think the actual, like movement of stuff between point A and point B, like, I think, like, the infrastructure is good at. From a core infrastructure standpoint, I do think, again, NetSeminar, I do think, like, think of all of the stuff that we try and do in networking, like fault isolation, load balancing, discovery, all of that stuff, security. I think you have to redo that at kind of the microservices level. And I think you have the insertion point to do that. And it just makes sense, right? This is the natural convergence of software, right? It's just like, you know, it takes a long time for industries and buying patterns to evolve. But I think we've evolved to the point that this is kind of what's happening.
And what about the areas where we're not good at, as you said, like authentication? It sounds like, I know there's a lot of discussion in container world. Can we actually isolate containers from one another? But it seems still that is like a very big issue that nobody's kind of addressing.
Yeah, well, I mean, authentication is a great example. I mean, you've got companies like Okta, right? I mean, it's like, it's one of these things, and this is a lot of value that these companies are doing at this kind of API gateway level, is they're providing these ways of, like, doing key management and key handling, and doing authentication. Again, it's almost like, it's a hell of a paradigm shift. Like, in the past, we're like, okay, what's an application? An application is, like, one single piece of code that runs in one process. You know, that was, like, the 1990 view, right? And then in the 2000s, like, oh, it's not just one application. You know, that application now is a distributed application, and there's many different pieces that have to talk to each other. And like, oh, then we retooled everything for distributed systems. You guys are still doing some of that work, right? I was saying there's another thing that's happening, which is like now we're federating those pieces, so you don't even own them. So now what is an application? An application is a call to remote stuff that you don't control far away that somebody else does. It may not be versioned, and whatever. I mean, that's another step in complexity. Like,
yeah.
You know,
managing that.
and it's two steps away from, you know, the single process thing.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's not like a classic distributed systems problem. I'm saying, like, you don't even have the data, you don't even know, you don't even control that entity. So we're even seeing arbitration layers. I mean, you know, here's another, is this recorded?
Yeah.
Okay. I'll give an obfuscated version of that story. So you can imagine that if there's a critical piece of functionality that you're using, that's an API, and that company goes away, you're SOL, right? So, okay, so that's not good. So here is where, like, people are now using, like, these general kind of libraries that say, let's say I want image recognition, right? So I want image recognition, so I'll use this kind of this middleman that I use their API for image, and then I'll arbitrage it on the back. Yeah. Does that make sense? Well, I'll do image recognition with them, and they're arbitraging on the back end. And every time they add a new image recognition player on the back end, they can distribute 30% of the workload across it. Does that make sense? And so, like, so basically, they're able to almost perfectly arbitrage across any provider of image recognition. So I think we're going to see a whole emergence of players that are providing infrastructure between the app developer and those who are offering API services.
Mm-hmm. So I think this is a good time to get some crowd questions.
Yeah.
Do you think that there's going to be like one or a small number of players that end up developing the majority of APIs that everybody uses?
That's a great question. So some people think the Big Bang does this, and like eventually that's the universe. Like, I'm like this optimist, right? I think it does this kind of thing, and I think IT does that too. I think it goes. Consolidation, explosion. And like, and the more I think about it, the more I believe that over, you know, 20 years now. And so I think we're in explosion phase for services. You'll always have a consolidation phase, but then we'll find another layer in the stack to go ahead and explode. Does that make sense? So I think for me, it's like, we're in explosion phase more generally right now. So mainframes, client server, right? Wow. And now we're definitely in the next computing phase. For sure. And we can talk about that. And I think also at the API level, like, what we're going to have is we're going to have this massive, chaotic, Darwinistic, you know, people investing, you know, years of their lives trying something that's not going to work, others being wildly successful, because the market doesn't really exist yet. We're still kind of pre-chasm. There's sufficient venture money out there to fund it, and so we're going to see this. And then once the thing matures and buying pattern matures, then you have natural consolidation along economic forces, which is like, you know, someone starts winning, like, they've got leverage, they can buy out others. But we're definitely not in that phase yet. It'll consolidate like it always does, and we're going to see an explosion somewhere else.
So in the short term, you don't think like the GCP ML APIs are going to wipe everything out?
Well, I mean, maybe for ML. But I'm talking like pretty much any business, I think, is going towards having an API, an interface. And seriously, there's a company we invested in, the only interface is an API, and they ship shit. Like, that's their business model, is I take atoms and I move them across the world, and the only interface is an API, which is suggested. And certainly even just in the computer science realm, like, there are so many things that applications do that are not ML AI that I think that there's a lot that's going to happen. And I think it's a totally great line of inquiry. And then people ask that question, it's a great question, but I think there's a ton out there.
So you were mentioning developers as buyers, and like, could you elaborate a little bit more on that? Because what I've heard is like, you know, discussions when you're kind of trying to sell software, it's, you know, it still happens to like the VPs and like these higher kind of folks. Like, how is the shift happening?
Okay, so this is one of my most favorite topics, but it's probably the least relevant, probably the most boring to you guys. So like, I'm just gonna do like a really kind of broad stroke, but yeah. Okay, so I was so naive when I got my PhD. Like, I got my PhD here, I'm like, I'm gonna do a company, right? It's all about technology, whatever. Like, when it comes to the enterprise, everything is about sales, everything. Like the economics of the company, like if you look at a company, the valuation of the company, all of it has to do with cost of sales. Like, nothing has to do with technology. Like, that's just what it is. Go to market trumps everything, right? It's sales. And it turns out sales is owned by the incumbents. Like, that's their real stranglehold. Like, if you like I would say like the number one race in the world, I mean, between like if you like reduce the challenge between startups and incumbents, it's like basically their ability to build sales versus their ability to do innovation. And we know how bad incumbents are in innovation, right? Horrible. Horrible. But that just goes to show you how hard it is to go about sales. Does that make sense? I mean, that's basically the race. If you want to reduce all of like entrepreneurship and innovation to one core tension, it's that tension. That's the tension. And it's for the following reason. So incumbents have sales locked up. They've got relationships with the customers that go back hundreds of years in some cases, like, and certainly dozens of years. You know, it was funny. I was personally selling into AT&T. Cisco had 1,000 people on the account, right? The incumbents have the channels locked up, like the people that actually sell your stuff, which actually sells the majority, and like the incumbents have leverage on their channels. So if you go to like some reseller and you're like, hey, carry my thing, and they're like, no, I sell $1 billion worth of like IBM stuff. If IBM doesn't like you, they'll be like, don't sell your thing, or we're going to pull our gear from them. They've got the analysts locked up, for sure, right? So the analysts, like, you go to Gartner, and then you convince Gartner they've got these relationships for a long time. And they got the customer locked up from like a certification perspective. They've been training them with CCIEs and all these other training things for a long time. So it's just like this very difficult thing to kind of poke through. So but that's been for core IT primarily, right? Like, there's like the core IT buyer, which like in the Livermore case where I was a programmer, that was the person that provided me the computer. So what's happened over the last 10 years is developers, because they align with the line of business, they're more of a profit center, right? And so, and because technology is moving up stack, it's becoming more software-based, it's more relevant to what they're doing. So more and more, they're actually controlling budgets. And then the way that they procure is very different than the way a core IT person, like, they don't care about Gartner at all, right? They don't. They don't care about expensive dinners, generally. They don't care about CCIEs, right? Like, they don't have business cards. I mean, the whole thing, right? What it looks like is happening is, if you're able to get to developers with, say, like, an open source project, you'll immediately get what we've always called in product marketing terms, top of funnel. So you'll actually get credibility with the account. You'll, you know, get access to the right decision makers. You don't have to like do the Gartner stuff. You'll actually get insertion and everything else. But you're right, you still have to build the sales force. And so if you really tease apart what's going on, it's like product marketing and top of funnel and lead gen is being replaced with open source and developer traction. And then you build a direct sales force on the back end to actually get the ELA and close the deal through procurement. Does that make sense? But by the way, this is very real. Like, if you look at GitHub, if you look at Atlassian, if you look at Mesosphere, these companies are making a tremendous amount of money in very little time by basically subverting the traditional marketing way of lead gen. But they all, like, I mean, Atlassian won't admit it, but they all basically have direct sales in order to do monetization.
So it sounds almost like the PhD heaven now, where you can really just come out with your PhD with like Git with an open source code and just build a Salesforce.
So no, but here's really interesting. Like, I don't think the world's ever been more tilted in favor of technical founders, because all of it, again, so this is just like every company now has to be front-ended by an API. It's like those in control of the dollars are developers, and who knows developers more than you, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, this is true, right? And so, the problem is, you know, that doesn't mean you can build a Salesforce. It's still hard to build a Salesforce, but like for the first time, you actually have direct access to the customer in a way you've never had before. But here's the downside. So do you guys know the difference between like consumer companies and enterprise companies in general? So here's the difference between a consumer company and an enterprise company, which is in a consumer companies, they all kind of look the same. So you have 10 companies that look the same. They don't have differentiated technology. Like, I have no idea if like their kind of core constituency is going to like it or not. So what you do is you basically wait to see if that phenomenon happens. Like, you wait to see if there's adoption. That's it. That's the only way that you know where to invest in a consumer company. Like, nobody can be like, yes, we like disappearing pictures. Like, very few people. So what you always do is you always look to see if there's up into the right type of adoption. Like, okay, something's happened. The consumer's there. Then you invest. Because if that doesn't happen, you have nothing. You don't have a team. You don't have core technology, you know, you don't have very much. And in the enterprise space, there's been a belief that there's actually core differentiating technology and you can actually do diligence on product market fit. Like the buying patterns of a 13-year-old girl, it's very difficult to predict, but for the core enterprise, it's not that difficult to predict. So one of the most interesting things that nobody's talking about because it's so new is it looks like developer adoption is more like a 13-year-old teenager. So it's now like enterprise companies are starting to look like consumer companies because like you have four open source database projects. Like maybe you're smart enough to do diligence to know which one developers are going to like or not, but like nobody's really figured that out. And so now you're seeing these companies like, yeah, so you can do an open source company, but if you don't get traction, you're actually left with nothing. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And so like there, you know, like you have to really kind of know what you're doing when you decide to do this. But if you have the breakaway project. And you haven't cannibalized yourself, which is not an easy thing to do. I mean, it allows you to build a company easier than you've ever been able to, with actually less cost.
Yeah, it sounds like it's very similar to like, you need to now get to the developer who likes the fan versus the developer.
Like, the developers are fickle. It's interesting. I mean, we actually studied just this phenomenon. Like the high level question was how fickle are developers? And the answer was like, they aren't fickle. Like, you know, like, it turns out it's really easy to get 5,000 developers, really easy. It's really hard to get 500K developers.
And the more you have APIs, the easier it will probably become to just switch off where you're working.
It's funny. There's another tension that I've been going through, which is the stickiest thing on the planet is data, right? It's just like data and data consistency, it's just so sticky. So if somebody is using the service that you provide to them, you've got a very rich data interface, we're doing the durability, whatever, like that's pretty sticky and they're not gonna go away. They're pointing their core business logic in you and like you've got a certain like, right? On the other hand, if you look at like kind of the way that serverless is going, like it's actually saying, oh, actually everything you do should be referentially transparent and like there's no state management, like that's not sticky at all. So definitely I think that if you're gonna be moving into space, you should be very sensitive to what is actually sticky from like an actual customer acquisition perspective versus what will just, you know, one layer of indirection will make you irrelevant. This conversation that we just had right here is so weird. This has never happened in business circles before because you never talk about a layer of indirection, you know, making like your primary sales motion irrelevant. But like, and like we're in this place where this is actually the case, right? Like that is, the API is the interface to the company.
So how would you actually go about building such a community, right? Like,
That is the question. So there's two things. Nobody knows how to capture the developer. Nobody knows. And if you do, it's this beautiful thing. I mean, look at GitHub. Like GitHub to me is like the classic example of like what you want. Okay. So first I look for up into the right adoption, and then I look for three or four different features of the company to determine whether it's interesting. So one of them. And a very important one is like, what type of developers do you get? Are you guys familiar with Parse? Yes, no. So Parse was kind of an online kind of API marketplace. It turns out all of the developers that they got were like either in startups or at home or whatever and fiddling around, and they weren't core developers. So first, you want to make sure that the type of developers you get are like core engineers on like an interesting product. The second one is you have to make sure that you're free from the open source bogey. And by that, I mean, if your core product is also your open source offering, sometimes it's really hard to get out from under that. Like, look at Nginx, man. That's probably the most deployed thing on the face of the planet. Very difficult to monetize. So you have to make sure that, like, you know, The third thing is like network effects are a beautiful thing no matter what type of business you're creating. And the fourth for me is like I don't like going after developer budget to your point because developer budgets tend to be fragmented, so you want to be able to sell somewhere else in the organization, like core IT. So look at GitHub. They don't even do the open source, right? Like, that's just on Linux. Like GitHub is proprietary. Right? It's a proprietary closed source service offering. But like the open source question doesn't come up because it's a service offering. So it turns out a hack you can do if you're going to do your company is like anything you offer as a service, nobody will ask you if it's open source or not. It's just this kind of weird kind of thing, like I don't really get. If you're shipping software, it has to be open source today. That game is over. Maybe you can ship an appliance, but you can't ship software anymore. But if you make it a proprietary service, people love it, right? So, okay. So this big proprietary thing, core developers, and then huge network effects, right? And so like, if I were you, like, you know, I don't think you can just like start cool open source project X from your dorm room and put it up and people use it and have a company. But if you're kind of sensitive to like these things that I talked about, I mean, I think that this is the new way of building companies. And I think that like it's all forming now, so there's a ton of opportunity.
No, it sounds like really monetizing the service side will be a big issue coming forward. Yeah.
I don't think so. Like, have you guys heard of a company called LaunchDarkly? Okay. Do you guys know what feature flagging is? Feature flagging, like, is this feature on or off? Like, it's a hugely successful company. The entire company is feature flagging. That's what it is. It's actually a PhD. He was under Alex Aitken. He was under Berkeley. He came out. I mean, they built like this thing. Basically, if you use their library, you can do feature flagging correctly. Just feature flagging, right? Which is, most of us would think is like some small component of the thing, but it turns out like if you're checking billions of feature flags and you're doing updates, you want to turn things on or off. It's actually a complex problem. So they have a CDN. Like they built this right. They have a CDN. They've got on caching. The guy's a real language guy, so it's like a great interface. So not only is a very small piece of software development turning into quite a successful company, like the deals are getting, they're big and very, very real. And so I would say two things. Number one, like when we started this here, we're like, we're changing all the networking, and it ended up being like virtual data centers. Like, you know, it's like I was looking at the original deck recently, and it was like 1% of the original vision. And it turns out to be a very large business. Like as you guys think about the space, like a very very focused vision in software development, I think has a tremendous amount of value and people will pay for it.
So nowadays you can go to credit card, get compute and storage. Now if you talk about end-to-end system, more specifically in the telecommunication space,
yeah.
And you look at these functions like catalog, so on, how do you see the band piece of it, you know, coming into play with blockchain and all that? I mean, do you see any?
You know, you guys in this room know way more than I do about blockchain. I know almost nothing. I see a ton of pitches on it. But here's my super naive, view of blockchain. They'll answer your question, which is the following. Like, so we have these entrepreneurs come in, and it's like, random problem, plus blockchain equals company. And then I always ask the question, what would happen if I did this with central ledger? What would I give up? And I've never once come up with a case that was outside of the regulatory issue where you couldn't do a central ledger. I've just never had. Like, as far as like an actual core differentiation. So, I mean, for me, you were asking about payments, where this is one of the areas where blockchain actually makes a lot of sense. But I think that people do throw around blockchain, especially now, in ways where I'm like, this is optimizing one fairly specific thing. I mean, as far as payments, I'm not the right person to answer like how blockchain. I mean, we're investors in Coinbase, we're investors in 21. We see a lot of these companies come. But what I think is even more interesting is like, I think the bigger trend is like we're actually seeing a movement to just actual micropayments. For me, it's really interesting. Like I actually see companies that are like charging for API call. And so the trend that I'm kind of tracking closer more than kind of like cryptocurrency type work is the fact that like I think there's actually real monetization potential, which is anytime you do an API call, I'll charge you a penny or a fraction of a penny. And this is all just like was. Yeah, for example, I actually think it's the big players that are causing this to happen, right? But like again, like this, it's almost like compute's becoming this fungible asset. But like it means something from like a business model perspective if you're doing being a startup. Like before, you actually couldn't do that because you didn't have the aggregation potential. And there are even companies that will do the aggregation for you now, right? Mm-hmm. So basically, you know, they will actually carry kind of the balance. You just have to use it up over a period of time. So you can charge somebody like a fraction of a penny, and then it will actually handle like kind of the loan until you fill it up. So I think that's a very interesting movement from even the system design perspective.
Yeah. So my question is more a specific part, I guess, company view. I wanted to ask about barefoot networks. And I just, maybe if you could give some of your thoughts on, I guess, how I guess programmable switches might influence like the standard settings bodies, the people hosting the data centers, and ultimately like the hardware vendors and manufacturers. How you kind of see all those playing together for them in order for them to be successful.
I appreciate the question, and I appreciate why you would ask that question. Like I don't feel comfortable representing another company. Like I don't feel comfortable. Because I think they would do a much better job representing themselves. Like I'm happy to talk more generally about like programmable networking and the industry. I just like barefoot specific. So you want me to talk more
generally?
Okay. So I think. So two things because you asked another question. So one of them, like, I hate standards bodies. I hate them. Like I've hated them for 15 years. I think they've stalled progress more than anything else on the face of the planet. Like I refuse to go ITF. I can't stand it. I think that basically what has happened is you've created these rooms full of people that aren't building systems, that argue, and then like if you're a startup, you don't have like you don't have the time or the resources to put someone in any of those rooms. You just don't. And if you do, they don't have a relationship with the time. And so basically, I mean, I think like the IHPs, like Qualcomm, are just great examples of this. We're like, we're still paying like, you know, licenses for LTEs. I just think like the whole standards thing is just like kind of a mess. It's the wrong way to do it. So that's why I love the shift to programmability and open source, because it's done by fiat. It's done by merit, right? It's like, listen, I will write something. If people find it useful, I have the standard. And it becomes a de facto standard. So in general, when it comes, again, this is clearly a very biased, very personal view, but having gone through this, like in the heart of it, like in the early days of Nasira, take for example, you know, so I mean, OpenFlow is great effort and a lot of work, but then as soon, like, you remember the days, right? We'd have like every vendor in there, and everybody's arguing, get nothing done. You end up with this like lowest common denominator bullshit, you know, crazy process. And then I remember I had this realization. I'm like, you know what? If we actually get something in the Linux kernel, do not take all R&D effort and focus on working on the Linux kernel. And as soon as that happens, like you basically create a standard. If people don't like it, you won't get in. I would say actually code review process is pretty rigorous. Like Dave Miller knows what he's doing on the Linux kernel. It's like he's not an idiot. Like I mean, I think that there's actually some merit to the way that you engage in those processes. Does that make sense? And so I'm all for like enabling programmability and open source and like allowing kind of like the court of like public development to be the way that could have come down. When it comes to actually programmability and networking, I think there's a ton of stuff we need to do. It entirely depends on where in the network it is and who's consuming it. So that's kind of a broader question. But I think in general, I love the idea of that versus standardization.
So then going back to like the point, I guess, in fast to me, so I guess the APIs and thinking about that shift of the buyer, do you think there would be like that same type of shift for networking if you were to do more of like a programmability and open source sort of environment? Or is it still like kind of
out too tight? I think it's very hard. I've been so painted of the last 15 years. It's very hard for me to think in the same way that you think anymore. And like it's to my detriment for sure. Like you can view all of networking as the same and solve these big problems, and that's fantastic. But like for me, I can talk about data centers, I can talk about like the WAN and stuff like that. I think they're very different, and I have very different answers to that. And like so, for example, in the data center, I don't think there's anything like this is like kind of, you know, I actually think in most cases
they have tracked it down people.
Yeah, I think in most cases, actually, like, you know, a lot of like end-to-end connectivity is kind of a done problem. But there's certain areas where you can do things. But in the ones that you do things, I think actually the supply chain, the person that has the power is the is the switch maker, not like some third party. Like, so I think like programmability, that would be a fantastic thing. And if you're a Silicon developer providing it, it's a fantastic thing, but it's a fantastic thing to the person that's building a switch in the vendor. And I think there's many reasons for that. But I don't think that it's going to enable some like third party relevant to build stuff and it's going to go on the network. I think it's more like creating feature horizontalization for the switch developers as opposed to the IHVs. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. I think it's very seductive to be like, networking is similar to compute, but I don't think that's a good analogy, because like compute, you solve problems like entertainment and physics, and like you and I use compute, where like networking is a fairly specific thing. So I think that most of like the urge to do differentiation does not come from app developers, it comes from actually switch vendors, and so that's what will drive the need to put programmability at that level. That makes sense?
Yeah, that makes sense.
So to kind of, we're reaching the end of the hour, so to kind of shift a bit to a different area, you've talked a lot about the edge becoming it's the new era of the edge, and we were talking about the rise of APIs. So I'm wondering, as a PhD student, right, like how do I enter all of this? Do you think that how I did a great open source project in my PhD, I don't know, I'm researching some new area. What do you think, what would be the way as a PhD student once you get into the startup world today? What do you give us an advice?
Okay, so PhD students get up into the startup world. It's a great question. I think so here's what have saved me years of my life. First, come talk to me. we'll have a conversation, and I'll help kind of structure the way you should think about this, because there's some stuff that's just not obvious. First, I would broadly understand if you're interested in doing something in the enterprise and consumer space. Just understand that, because your life will be entirely different, and the way you think about the world will be entirely different. Like, you'll wake up with different like ideas in your head depending on what you decide to do. I'm an enterprise guy. You decide to do something in the enterprise, it's only an hour or two conversation, but have a conversation without someone that understands what that means, and then actually listen to them, because I didn't. You know, it's interesting. So many of the things that you will think are intuitive are not intuitive. Like, for example, there's probably no single decision you can make, not one, that'll impact your valuation more than the decision on pricing. And the reason this is because all of your variable costs in a company are around sales, and like, salespeople are expensive, and your pricing basically gives you your margin. That's it. And that's basically the most important decision. So what people like me want to do, who are entrepreneurs, to think, you know what, actually, like, getting stuff out to more people is really important, and then later I'll sell them stuff up because I'm an innovator, and then I'm going to raise the prices, so I'm going to have real low pricing, get out to everybody, and then upsell. Every single entrepreneur I talk to does this for the technical background. It's an intuitive thing, and it's totally, totally wrong. It fails any test of like buying psychology, it fails any test of pricing. So what I would suggest is, listen, you guys are like Shaolin monks that have been spending your entire life doing like one thing, and you're like the best at like kind of technical Aikido and Kung Fu, and like, that's great. You guys will all be amazing founders. Take the time to do a little bit of diligence on what it means to do a company, and what are the important things, and whether you're the person to actually drive those executive decisions or not. And then go for it. I mean, I don't think it takes much more than that. I mean, I think that there's a lot of really interesting spaces. I think that you're going to pivot anyway before you do it. So I don't think the bar is very high, but I think that you can save yourself a couple of years by really understanding that, like, the business side is pretty important.
And how did you end up finding your research direction was led up to a startup? Like, how can I, is there any direction you would recommend? Like, what can I, as a PhD student right now, kind of lock in my own world actually do to expand?
From how did I find a research project, or how did I go for the research project?
Yeah, how did I go for the research startup?
Yeah, so I actually did two startups. here's two things I learned. I did two startups. One while I was a PhD student, one when I left a PhD student. And both times, I did it because I was pissed off because people told me it wouldn't work. And both times I tried to give it away, and nobody would take it. And so here's the really interesting thing that I learned, which is like, it's way easier to sell somebody something than script. It's way easier. I don't know what the psychology is behind it, probably because they don't attach value or whatever. In this case, like honestly, like I knew there was a pony there somewhere. We knew there was a pony there somewhere. We knew that we were directionally correct. We knew it was interesting. We knew we were compelling. Wasted 3 years in the wilderness. Like just no idea what we were doing. Like kind of figured out the core technology and so forth. And so, like, and the reason I say that is like, listen, if you're interested in making that transition, like, it's not that big of a stretch. I mean, like, if you're doing a research project, even if nobody likes it, even if nobody would pay for it, that doesn't mean that there isn't a big company behind it. And if you decide to go step out and do that company, just know what you're getting into. And I think that there's a lot of upside to have as a result. So this is not good guidance. It's just more like, don't, like, I think a lot of the times you think like, oh, I need to have this amazing thing with a lot of interest and this huge potential. Like, that's not necessarily the case. And in fact, I think that some of the bigger ideas are the ones where, like, you know, like it's a huge market you're going after and hugely disruptive, but like you can't even get a meeting. Because that to me is like where real category creation happens.
And did you actually follow like the industry well in research, or was it?
No? I wish I did. I would have been way better off. Yeah, I really wish I did.
Question. So now that we have software-defined everything, software-defined van, networking, data center, how do you see the convergence and adoption of this in the industry? Like the panel that you were giving in enterprise world, they have locked down the hardware, the channel, and they sell you everything from switch to the firewall. So when these things are fragmented, how do you see them?
Yeah, that's a really good question. So who do you think is getting cannibalized by software-defined van?
The big box
vendors. I think so. So I think it's actually the telcos. I think that the primary use case is L2L3 DPN. You know, my experience with Masero is not like Cisco phase attacks. I think you're actually going a little bit over middle box vendors and a little bit over new. It's really interesting. Like, I do think now we're starting to see the beginnings of price pressure and cannibalization from white box, but that's almost a price arbitration play that's happening. And so I've been really surprised by how the dynamics have played out actually in the market, and they've been kind of very different than we'd originally anticipated. So I think that your question is the right question to answer or ask. I don't think the answers are very clear, but every time I start to see like someone successful in the space, like the person that the budget's being taken out of is not kind of who I expected to be taken out of. Does that make sense? And so I think over time, and a lot of the reason is like in many cases in networking, the capital cost of the equipment is just like not a large portion of like the total spend for whatever it's going into, right? I mean, like networking is maybe 9% of the total data center spend, right? And so like actually going out of that capital cost isn't sufficiently compelling, like if that's your primary pitch in order to do that. On the other hand, like, I mean, there's tons of millions of dollars spent in like, you know, private, you know, L2, L3 DPNs. And so I think this is a really interesting space to go after, but this whole idea that like it's gonna somehow put pressure on like the traditional like switch supply chain, I think is proving out to be less true than we originally thought. That was a big I don't know, just to be more concise. Yeah.
Since you talked a lot about APIs, I'm curious about your opinion about the cloud computing layer that sits right below the APIs. So out of all the public clouds, like the AWS of the world, which ones do you think are gonna win, and what do you think differentiating factors are?
That's a great question. So I'm gonna answer a different question, which is I think where this is all going is all of the powers of the app. You know, it's kind of funny. Like, I mean, we're infrastructure people, so we think about, you know, the cloud and the infrastructure. But if you look at it from a customer perspective, like the app is actually disintermediating infrastructure. So let's talk about like, you know, some random bank X. I mean, they consume Salesforce and they consume Evernote and they consume all of these SaaS applications. And whether it's running in a cloud or not, I don't think actually in the limit matters. And so it took me a while to really understand how true this is. So because I was an infrastructure guy, I really kind of, is it Amazon, is it Google, how's that gonna play out? You know, what's gonna happen? And then I found out the actual, like all of the power on the top of the value chain, and that which has the customer control and the account control is actually the SaaS guys. Like, they're the ones that are the end of the value chain, right? And so I think we're even already starting to see them kind of arbitrage these clouds on the back end themselves. So it's not the enterprise, it's not General Mills, it's not, you know, Goldman Sachs, it's not JPMC, it's not the actual, what we consider an enterprise customers, it's the actual SaaS guys that are doing that. So my sense is this becomes actually a real arbitration play. It, I think a lot of the stickiness is not going to go all the way through to the end customer, and I think this is why like actually Microsoft is in such a powerful position. So I think like Amazon basically has like first mover advantage and the defined laws of physics of their execution executing like crazy, and I think that Microsoft owns the application and owns the developer, and that's where their stickiness is. And I think you're going to see arbitrage between kind of Amazon and Google. So I think that will even up a little bit. But if you want to look to like how the dynamics are playing out, I think actually looking at like what they built by themselves is probably the wrong place to look. I think the right place to look is like who has the leverage and the power when it comes to buying. And I really think it's the SaaS guys.
So you think the platforms themselves are very complex?
I think over time they'll be arbitraged by the SaaS guys. Like, does it really matter whether Facebook runs on-prem or not, or Netscape runs on-prem or not, or Salesforce or Workday or any of these? I mean, like the consumer, like the ultimate consumer sees the app in most cases. Not in all cases, in most cases. And so I think that's actually, like, if you want to like look long-term trends, I think that's who controls the flow of money, and they will turn into an arbitration play. And I think that's why you're starting to see these big deals go to Google Cloud, and it's obviously these large SaaS guys because they actually have the in-house expertise for doing this. So I think it's very difficult to take something that's surfaced in Amazon and take it all the way to the end consumer. I think that's a very difficult thing to do. You basically, so then you say, where does it go? Well, that thing is being consumed by a SaaS person. That SaaS person has access to the consumer. So now you've disintermediated the infrastructure of the cloud people from the end consumer. And I think that's where you get like the level of arbitration.
So obviously the consumer doesn't care at all which cloud platform their app is running on. But the, and I totally agree that the app makers provide most of the value to the consumer, but the app makers themselves pay a ton of money to the cloud platforms. So in terms of making money, the cloud platform differentiation actually will matter.
Well, but it's an arbitration play. I mean, basically, like now you've got the, it's like Broadcom or Bell, right? I mean, it's like anytime you have like basically two sources, and they've got a huge R&D teams and huge technology or whatever, but you have someone that basically owns the consumer, you have to do dual vendor arbitration. I just think like economically, everything you're saying is correct. 100%, and I think it's a great line of inquiry. I just think that, like economically, the way this plays out is that writes the check, actually has a sales motion with both of them. It's going to use arbitration for pricing pressure, and then over time, I think this converges into, now maybe there's sufficient technical differentiation that's so big that the consumers themselves can't overcome it. But like, given the numbers that we're talking, the actual like power of the SaaS players, we're talking like, you know, Apple and Facebook and like these guys are slouches, right? Snapchat. I think that they'll have sufficient leverage to do arbitration. That's just a guess, but.
So I've heard a bit that it's kind of been slow for a lot of companies to move from on-prem to the cloud. And like, I mean, do you have ideas on why that is? I've heard a little bit about security and stuff like that. But.
No, I just think that, you just can't take that enterprise workload and move to. I just think it's just fine. Like normal innovation pattern. It's like any new project can go to the cloud.
Yeah.
Taking a little project to move to the cloud is basically impossible. And so, I mean, that's basically what hybrid cloud is I've got new shit in the cloud, and I've got old shit like in my data center, and I'm connecting them over like a secure link. That's what hybrid cloud is today. It's not like I'm building something that's on-prem and off-prem, and like there's got some fluidity between the two. At least in my experience, I mean, like we've dealt with hundreds of these customers, and it's like we're just following an innovation cycle, I think.
What do you think is going to be happening on the hardware level over the next, let's say, 3 to 7 years with all this happening on not only the software player?
I don't have a good answer, honestly. I mean, like, I feel like in the data center, like over time, basically, like it's speeds and feeds. Right? And it really is. And not like it was. You know, 10, 15 years ago, like, we're still trying to put differentiation in the hardware, like, we're, like, putting special tags on there, like, the tag and all sorts of other stuff. I think that in the data center, speeds and feeds. And, I mean, which is a market, and it is whatever it is, but, I mean, it's, like, I think, like, most new companies, the way they view, like, a data center network is, okay, it's, like, a big, huge switch with a whole bunch of ports. I put a packet in one, and it pops out another one, and it does it with some sort of price performance and reliability. I mean, I think that's kind of the technical problem, and, like, I think we're getting pretty close. Like, I mean, like, big improvements in power density, great. Improvements in price performance, great, but, like, that's going to be the driving thing, which in the past, it's, like, here's some new use case or whatever. I don't think that'll be the driving thing anymore. So I think it really is about price performance and, at least in the data center. I mean, I think in the way and other areas, I mean, I think that there's, and you guys all know this better than I do. I'm just starting to get into it, but I think there's going to be a massive change in mobile access for sure. Like, we're starting to see that now. It's like a massive change. But this is more just kind of supply chain type stuff. Like, I think that you'll take a zero out of deployments.
So we have time for like one more question.
So I had a question with respect to APIs and stateless versus stateful. You know, these API providers, if they're stateless, they don't have to worry too much about the data integrity issues other than managing their own business from a data perspective. And the data issue becomes the user of the API. So, versus if they become stateful, then they have all those problems. So how do you see this? How do you see the data issue as a data pain points?
I think you're exactly right. I mean, to me, I just can't imagine. Okay, this just seems to be true. You can't build a company that has algorithmic differentiation. It just seems to be true. It's just like, it's just too hard to differentiate just via an algorithm. Like, you need to have data differentiation or a data mode. There's so few examples of like, I had a better algorithm, I have a successful company. And I think that when it comes to the move towards APIs, I mean, I think that the companies are gonna have to do something that's sticky, that's dealing with data and something more transactional. I don't think they have any choice because, I mean, I've actually invested in a company that actually is an algorithm company. It's like the number one, context optimization company in the world. So they basically have an API, you call it an API, and they'll do kind of multi-dimensional optimization better than anybody else. But they are so rare and so infrequent that you have these, and it's just a bunch of like Cornell PhDs that just kind of think about like how to solve this better, and it's a computationally hugely intensive problem. So I think pretty much any viable company that has an API will have to have built some stickiness with data. And I think actually ML is like making this problem more acute, which is, it's looking like, I mean, like, the more data that you have access to, kind of the more that you can use for training and everything else like that. So I think in the end of the day, this all becomes a data problem anyways. I mean, I think that's it. I mean, at the end of the day, like, you have to be dealing with lots of data, you have to have access to lots of data, and that's your long-term defensibility from a company perspective. I don't think this can happen.
To get really briefly into sort of like geopolitics almost, all the APIs that you've been talking about tonight are just straight up blocked in China by the big firewall for most of them. Do you have any thoughts on that? Or how long China is.
Yeah, that's actually a really, really great question. We're spending a lot of time trying to understand China. And so I don't have a good answer for you. It's a great question. And like, it seems to me like you're creating a parallel economic environment and economic ecosystem with one of growing power that's like fairly disconnected from the user base and technology base and so forth. And so it'll be interesting to see how they reconcile.
Great. Thank you for speaker.
All right. Thanks.